Hey everyone! Whether you are a student or professional, there may come a time in which you want to share information with a large group of people through the use of a slideshow. And two of the most common ways of making a slideshow are through either Microsoft's PowerPoint or Google Slides. In today's episode, we're going to take a look at some of the things that you really don't want to do when you're making a slideshow, because you want to be able to communicate information effectively with your audience and clearly without falling prey to some of the common errors that people may make. So, let's get going.
To review what to do and what not to do in a slideshow, I'm going to use this PowerPoint that I had made. And one of the very first things that everybody needs in their slideshow is a great title slide. And for that, you need to have an awesome sounding title that stands out from the background. Here it is, how to make a great slideshow presentation. Don't forget to include your name and the date in which you had created the slideshow. And of course, if there are certain requirements that your teacher is expecting, make certain that those are included in your title slide. One very important thing about any slideshow is that you make certain that it includes both visual imagery as well as text. So this is extremely important. Balance the text with good pictures. The pictures help to break up the text and creates visual interest. Just make certain that the pictures you use are either original photos that you've already taken with your own camera, original drawings that you yourself have created, or images that are copyright friendly. If you use images that others have created, you're going to have to make certain that you give the proper attribution credit both underneath the picture and in your reference page, and we'll talk more about the reference page later on. But a great place to find copyright-friendly images is this website called pixabay.com. Another great place to go to is creativecommons.org, and that includes Pixabay as well as a wide variety of other places where you may find images. However, many of those other images are not necessarily copyright and attribution-free, so just something to keep in mind. For additional slide design tips, here is an image that I did obtain from Pixabay. Again, it's copyright and attribution free. But as you go from slide to slide, make certain that you change the location of the images. You don't want all of them always on one side of the slide, top, bottom, left, right. Also, don't overwhelm your audience by including too much information on a slide. Generally speaking, use no more than 4 to 5 bullet points. Less is generally better. Of course, there may be exceptions to the rule, but again, these are general guidelines. Always remember that your goal is to communicate information clearly to your audience and to engage them. So use powerful images and make certain that those images are appropriate for your target audience. Again, this is another great example of an awesome image that I happened to get from Pixabay.com. Also, make certain that you make good use of space. Never crowd your images and text together, that just becomes confusing for your audience. Make good use of symmetry. Try to achieve a balance when positioning items both within a slide and between slides. Another example of symmetry is if you have a picture on one side of the slide, be aware of where the central line of the slide is so that you can put the text exactly opposite from the image. Also, always make certain that you use a font type, size, and color that's easy to read. If they're not easy to read, they will frustrate your audience. For example, this is rather frustrating to read. This is an example of what not to do. And you know what? I've actually seen this where people have had slideshows with an orange background with a font color that's very difficult to read against the background. Why on earth would you want to do this? Your goal is to engage your audience, not frustrate them. So make certain that you use a font color that stands out from the background. Also, don't try to impress people by using a fancy font type, for example, a cursive font. The only thing that you're going to achieve, once again, is frustrating your audience and making them disengage from what you're trying to communicate. Instead, use fonts that are easy to read, like Century Gothic, Times New Roman, Arial, Verdana. For many teachers, Times New Roman is the accepted standard. It's also frequently the accepted standard in the business world. Also, please don't write full paragraphs on your slides. Nobody is here to read a novel. They just want the basic points of information given to them. That's why bullet points are very useful. And again, make certain that you use appropriate images to help break up the text and create visual interest. Use a consistent slide design. You know, find one at the very beginning that you like and then stick to it, commit to it. Don't jump from one style to another. And whatever you do, never create boring slides. Even if you're covering statistical or scientific information, use a variety of images like bar charts and Venn diagrams, flowcharts. This again just helps create visual interest by introducing variety into the information that you're communicating to the audience. And always remember, many people are visual learners, so make effective use of imagery. This is vital to maintain audience interest. Other things to consider? Make certain that everything is spelled correctly. No one likes to see misspelled words. Nobody's going to take you seriously. No one will think that you're professional if you have misspelled words, if you have incorrect grammar on your presentation. It shows that you're trying to rush or that you just didn't care to make a great slideshow for your audience. Also, when you're there in person, avoid reading it. You know, you have to maintain great eye contact. That means you have to be familiar enough with your material so that way you can summarize it and add context. You don't want to be standing up there reading the entire slideshow because then you will not have this great eye contact. Eye contact is critically important. Something else to keep in mind, whatever you do, avoid transitions between slides that are distracting. And excessively long. Usually, you will be better off with no transitions between slides at all. In fact, earlier in this presentation, there were no transitions and the slideshow was great. Also, don't use sound effects between slides. Come on, most people consider the use of sound effects to be immature and unprofessional. I mean, again, there may be some situations where sound effects and busy transitions might be effective. For example, if you're presenting to a very young age group, then yeah, maybe the sound effects will help them become more involved with what you're presenting. But if you're at business meeting, if you're in college, even if you're high school, don't use the sound effects. All right, something that's very important is give credit to the sources in your slideshow. All right, whenever you paraphrase the source, and what that means is you are significantly putting information from a source into your own words. And I want to emphasize significantly, changing I don't to I do not. That is not significantly changing the wording. So when you are paraphrasing a source, you have to give credit to where the information came from. You must also do that when you directly quote a source. And please use direct quotes sparingly. If you use too many direct quotes, then your audience will believe that you cannot come up with original thoughts on your own. A direct quote should only be used if you are citing an expert to substantiate what it is that you're trying to say about your topic, or if it's a famous person whose exact words will help to add emphasis to what you are trying to communicate. So, how do you go about giving credit to your sources? Well, that depends upon the formatting style that you have chosen or that has been assigned to you. Three of the very common formatting styles are MLA, known as Modern Language Association, frequently used with the liberal arts. Also, there is the American Psychological Association, or APA, used a lot in science, also used a great deal in graduate school. And there's the Chicago style, frequently used in social studies. All right, some examples of how to use a parenthetical citation after a paraphrase. In APA, you would include the author's last name and the publication date. As you can see here, we have Finocchiaro, 2008. So the author's last name, a comma, and the publication date. In MOA, you would have the author's last name, followed by the page number, where he got the information from. And in Chicago style, it's a combination of both of those, the author's last name, the publication date, a comma, and a page number. Now, there may be many variations on these formulas based upon the type of information source you're using, like an academic journal, a newspaper, a book, etc. And exploring all those variations, it goes beyond the scope of this presentation. Some great resources are out there, though, such as the Purdue Online Writing Lab, which will help you out a great deal in creating these parenthetical citations, and also your reference works cited bibliography page. One thing to remember, though, is every source for which you have a parenthetical citation must match up with a source listed on that last slide. The works cited, if you are writing in MOA style, the reference page, if you're writing in APA style, or the bibliography, if you're writing in Chicago style. This is an example of a reference page, which is in APA style. As you can see here, you have the author's last name, comma, the first letter of their first name, the first letter of their middle name, the date of publication in parentheses, the title of the article, and in APA style, the first word of the title is capitalized and any proper nouns, the name of the journal, the volume number, the issue number, the page numbers, the date that the article was retrieved, and the source of that retrieval. This is a database. Here we have a book. Here we have lecture notes. So the way in which you format a source of information is going to vary depending upon what the source is and what style you are using. But one thing to note is that whatever style you're using, many of the research databases that are out there will actually give you options for helping you to develop the reference entry of your article. So that's one of the strengths of using a research database. Also, there are many online tools such as EasyBib that may prove very useful for creating the citation on your reference page. So, to sum this up, make very good use of images, make certain that you have a reference page, make certain that you provide parenthetical citations for any information that you paraphrase or directly quote, have a great balance between images and text, don't overwhelm the audience with too much text, and always have fun.
Thank you once again, everyone, for watching this episode of Classroom Digital Tools. Please subscribe to my channel, like the video by giving it a thumbs up, spread the word, share this with your friends, and if you haven't done so, please take a look at all the other videos that are available on Classroom Digital Tools. There are some exciting things coming up, including a wide variety of travel vlogs, so stay tuned. Thank you again for your support, and you have a great day.